Starting the session, I would like to ask you to imagine a solution or a particular middleware platform that you would design for your organization. And then if I asked, in order to build this particular platform, if you require an ESB or identity server or application server, you wouldn't have a particular answer at this point because you will take some time to figure it out. But if I asked if you have requirements for schema transformations, like XML to XML, or some content type switching kind of transformations, like XML to JSON transformations, or transport switching, or identity management relevant stuff, like facilitating your solutions with single sign-on, or securing your existing APIs with the use of open protocols like OAuth or OpenID Connect, then you will have some answers. The basic thinking behind the WSO2 Carbon platform, or the architecture of the Carbon platform, is exactly similar to this one, because when we have designed this particular Carbon platform, first of all, we have imagined about all the requirements that you would have for your solutions or middleware platforms without thinking about the boundaries or any product in particular. So based on that, we have developed so many features in order to represent each and every functionality that you would require within your middleware platform. And we have maintained, we are maintaining a feature repository. These features are stored as modules, so those could be used in order to construct some kind of a solution or product that you would like to create. If you have observed any of WSO products, you might have seen that there are so many commonly applicable features or commonly used features, such as every WSO product has the capability of running itself as a server, a standalone server. And then, of course, every WSO product can be clustered. And every WSO product has a basic logging mechanism and registry mechanism. Just like that, there are so many common features. So we have identified these commonly applicable features, and we have constructed something called Carbon Core, or the Carbon Kernel. So this Carbon Kernel has all of these common features. And then, having identified the domain-specific features, such as the requirements that we discussed already, like XML schema transformation, or content type switching, or facilitating your solutions with a single sign-on. Just like that, there are so many domain-relevant features. So having installed these kind of domain-relevant features on top of this Carbon Core, we have constructed products. So this is called the WSO2 Composable Server Architecture. And because of this composable architecture, you have the capability of handling this kind of a scenario. For example, you might have an already installed ESB installation, and you have a particular requirement in order to host a single web application. So you don't want to have a separate server or separate application server in order to host this web service. In that case, you have the capability of installing web container feature, or the web hosting, web service hosting feature on top of the ESB installation that you have. And that functionality can be gained through the WSO2 ESB after that. So I just went through this composable server architecture because the next slide is about the deployment of these products. So you can see at the top, we have separate runtimes like WSO2 Enterprise Service Bus, API Manager, and Identity Server. These are the products that you would find in the WSO2 website. You can download and just run. Then we have something called combined instance. This is a concept. This is what we discussed earlier. Having identified some features that would make sense to integrate with each other, you have the capability of combining some of the products into one runtime. For example, enterprise service bus and message broker, and different profiles of WSO2 API manager combined into the same runtime or the same JVM environment, and application server and data services server, because those are some relevant products, because data services server provides a way to expose your databases in the form of web services. So application server does the same, hosting your web services, so it makes sense. But when you have to do something like this, it has to be done very carefully and wisely, because in a production environment, you don't have to, you don't want to overload your virtual machines or the runtime with so many unwanted features. And when we discuss about deployment and capacity planning, first of all, we need to figure out the architecture of the solution that you are going to build. So for that, you need to gather requirements first, obviously, and picture the architecture of your solution. It can be some drawings or whatever you would use in order to depict the solution that you are going to construct. And then when you imagine this kind of a solution, you can identify some logical components within this particular solution based on the requirements or the domain that each and every requirement would represent. So just like that, we can discuss that in the next slide as well. This is the logical architecture that I was talking about. So you can see there are some logical components such as API subscription, API administration, API traffic handling, mediation, dashboards, analytics, security, just like that. Based on the domain that each and every requirement of this particular solution would represent, you can have some logical separation between these categories or components, so that you would be able to use some kind of a product that is available in the industry in order to construct each and every component of this particular solution. So you can see now we have added WSO2 API manager to API subscription, API traffic handling, API administration, and for the mediation layer, we have added WSO2 ESB and service and API hosting, WSO2 application server, and for security, WSO2 identity server, just like that. Then you can figure out what are the products that you have to install in order to construct this particular solution. And when it comes to capacity planning, you need to determine the volumes to be handled. And under that, these factors should be discussed, such as the required throughput and concurrency requirements, and the maximum tolerable latency, and average data packet size, and the work per transaction, which means if you have a situation to handle a simple HTTP based some message, a smaller message, it can, it's a different kind of a transaction. But if you have a larger file to handle, like a larger XML file to be transformed and transferred, then of course it needs some more capacity. So those facts has also need to be considered. And while determining these values or the factors, you can use your existing monitoring systems and existing business and marketing statistics and available data volumes. Like if you have so many larger data sources to be integrated with this particular solution, then you have to consider some capacity information relevant to that. And of course, you would have your own organizational mechanism in order to project your future capacity requirements. So those information can be used while doing the capacity planning. And first of all, you need to determine the capacity requirements for your solution. This is a hypothetical solution that we would be using as an example. And then you need to check the capacity of each product, because WSO2 performs some tests to determine the capacity of each and every product, the latest versions. So you can get these values in order to do the capacity planning. Then based on these two values, you have the capability of determining how many instances that each and every product cluster would require. So that can be done after gathering this information. Then of course you have to consider how to handle high availability and how to address high availability and how to handle failover situations. Those have to be considered while determining the instances count and the deployment. So this is a sample calculation. So if an instance of WSO2 ESB or any other product, for example, I have taken WSO2 ESB, if it has to handle, if it handles X requests, X amount of requests or transactions within a second, to handle Y amount of transactions within a second, a cluster of WSO2 ESB requires N number of nodes or instances when N equals this particular expression. In the diagram, you can understand it properly. The red thick line represents the original load, and we add, in order to calculate this particular value, we would add some tolerance of 30% of the initial original load value. Then if an instance of the ESB or any other WSO2 product can handle X amount of requests, we need to collect the sum the amounts of the original load and the tolerance, and then it should be divided by the capacity that an instance of that particular product can handle. So just like that, you can calculate the number of instances. But depending on the latest R&D work and the improvement of the products, the mechanisms of calculating the node count can be vary. So definitely you would have to consult a WSO2 staff member in order to get precise information when you have to define the instances count just like that. And when we cluster a particular installation of WSO product, this is how we have to do it. You can see we have used a load balancer in front of the cluster, and the production traffic is divided or distributed to the worker nodes of this particular cluster through the load balancer, and the management console or admin API's related traffic is routed directly to the manager node of that particular cluster. And we have something called deployment synchronization feature, or simply DepSync. It utilizes an external SUN repository in order to distribute the configuration artifacts. So once something is published using the admin APIs or the admin manager console or any other mechanisms such as Puppet or Chef kind of automation script, those artifacts will be published into the external SCN repository. Then the management node will notify the worker node in order to fetch these changes and apply those to the runtime. So that is how the deployment synchronization happens. And there are some databases have been shared with these nodes of this cluster. User management DB is typically being used in order to have the user account related information and permission model. And the registry DB is basically being used in order to share some configuration artifacts among the nodes of a particular cluster. Then we may consider the deployment of this particular solution, the hypothetical solution. And assuming that we are planning for the minimum possible capacity, you can see we have clustered each and every component having installed two active instances. So this is the recommended way to handle this, because this provides more high availability. So if one node goes down, definitely there is another node in the active state in order to take the traffic and handle it. But of course, so, you have the capability of installing these instances in active passive modes as well. But this is not the basic the recommendation, WSO2 recommendation. technically you can have this kind of installation within a single single data center, and you can replicate this particular setup into another data center and maintain that data center in the passive mode in order to handle failover scenarios. But within the data center, this is the recommended way to handle. And in this diagram, it also depicts that the API manager gateway or the API traffic handling component, it has been depicted as a cluster that remains in the DMZ. You can see the color code, which is indicated in red. So just like that, when you have your solution, when it comes to deployment, there will be this kind of situations that you have to handle, because technically the API gateway is handling the externally generated traffic, which is facing to the outside of the internal network. Because of that reason, we have the capability of distributing these components among the local area network and DMZ, depending on your requirement. Depending on the requirements and the best practices. Deployments of products. When you deploy these products, you have to basically decide what would be the deployment mode and the infrastructure that you have to provide. Basically, we support on-premise and cloud-based deployments, so you can choose any of these. And you need to read the WSO2 hardware specification in order to prepare your virtual machines sticking to that particular hardware specification. Then you can just extract the binaries of WSO2 products into your VMs and configure the clusters in order to construct that particular solution. This is some kind of overview for the hardware specification. This also can be varying in future, but this is the current recommendation. So it is based on the number of JVM or the WSO2 instances count. So we use both both words JVM and WSO2 or carbon instances in order to discuss about any single binary installation of WSO2 product, because it spawns its own VM, JVM, so that is why we call it as a JVM instance as well. So when it comes to deployment, we would recommend you to keep one CPU for the JVM instance to operate, and 2 GB of RAM for the JVM instance, and 10 GB of hard disk space. And again, for the operating system to perform, you need to allocate one CPU and 2 GB of RAM as well. And following these basics, you can configure your own VMs, or if you are going for Amazon kind of a deployment, Amazon EC2 kind of a deployment, following this spec, you can select whatever the instance that you have to purchase. This is a visual representation of the same concept that I mentioned. You can see there are two types of VMs here. One VM has two CPUs, 4 GB of RAM, having allocated 2 GB of RAM for the JVM instance or the WSO2 instance to operate, and we have left the other 2 GB of RAM for the OS to operate. And if you select a larger VM, you can have multiple products instances installed in the same VM. Then again, you have to increase the resource pool accordingly, allocating 2 GB of RAM for each and every JVM instance. And for each and every JVM instance, you need to increase the CPU count by one as well. So this is about elastic scaling capabilities. So if you define, if you construct your clusters in a static manner, when the load becomes load increases, at some point it wouldn't be able to deliver the output that you are expecting. So in that case, you need to think about scaling, dynamic scaling, or the elastic scaling of this kind of deployments. Then of course you can have elastic scaling mechanisms. There can be so many elastic scaling mechanisms that you could use. basically, with the WSO2 managed cloud offering, we are using Amazon AWS based deployments. There you can have like Amazon CloudWatch kind of applications in order to watch the load and increase the JVM counts or the VM counts properly in order to match this incoming traffic. And this is something about sharing the registry of WSO2 based installations, because when you deploy any kind of a WSO2 solution, basically you have product instances within the cluster. Then you need to have a way to share some configuration artifacts or governance artifacts within these nodes of among these nodes of the cluster. So basically, within the registry, we maintain three different spaces. First one is the local registry. The second one is the configuration registry, and the third one is the governance registry. So usually, in a typical deployment, what we would do is we would keep the local space or the local registry to have the information that would be relevant to that particular instance. It is not shared between any other instance. And the configuration node is typically maintained in order to store the configuration that would be relevant to a particular product cluster. It is not shared across other clusters, but within a cluster. For example, if you have two installations of WSO2 ESB and WSO2 Identity Server, one configuration registry is shared among the nodes of WSO2 ESB installation, and the other configuration node can be shared among the nodes of the identity server installation. And the governance registry space is shared across all the clusters. So the same governance space will be visible to the ESB cluster and the IS cluster and any other product cluster that you would have. However, when we deploy these instances, you can have you can maintain all of these data sources or the registry spaces within the within that particular installation, or rather you can move something like the governance node of it to an external external data source, which would be connected to the WSO2 governance registry, so that you could perform lifecycle management and versioning kind of governance relevant activities over these artifacts. Again, similarly, you can move the configuration registry also to the external database and manage configuration artifacts using the WSO2 governance registry. Also, you can have separate governance registries in order to manage configuration registry and governance registry. So those are some possible deployments. Anyway, this registry mounting, for this registry mounting, we are providing two mechanisms called the WS mounting and shared registry based remote registry mounting. So those capabilities are there. So the next slide is the last slide. It has a reference to some of the documentation pages that we have on the WSO2 documentation website, because there are some products that would have its own deployment patterns. Those would be specific to this specific product. So this is an example for the WSO2 API manager. The red line indicates the DMZ and the separation between the DMZ and the LAN. You can see the two API gateway nodes are in the DMZ, while the other components remain within the local area network. And in the first pattern, you can see the publisher and the store profiles of WSO2 API manager have been combined into one and deployed as a one single instance. So anyway, when it comes to WSO2 API manager, the deployment is somewhat different. It has four basic profiles where you have to distribute these profiles into multiple places when it comes to a real production situation. So those are there in the documentation, and I don't have much time to spend on that. Yeah, so